Welcome to Deansgrange Cemetery, about 10 kilometres south of Dublin, Ireland's capital city. My name is Michael O'Flaherty, and today I'm going to talk about some of the notables buried here and the exceptional monuments erected in their memory. So come with me. Located beside the small village of Deansgrange, the cemetery opened in 1865. Anastasia Carey was the first person to be buried in here. She died of typhoid fever and lies in a plot of the Daughters of the Heart of Mary. The nuns ran St. Joseph's Orphanage in Kingston, where Anastasia worked as a servant. Deansgrange was the fourth cemetery to open in the suburbs of Dublin during the 1800s. After Golden Bridge in 1828, Glasnevin in 1832, and Mount Jerome in 1836. These cemeteries were developed to address the shortage of burial spaces after many of the old churchyards had become overcrowded. The layout of Deansgrange was relatively new. It was designed as a garden cemetery, not only as a place to dispose of the dead, but also as a park-like setting where mourners and visitors could find peace and solitude. Unlike older church graveyards, where religious affiliations determine where people could be buried, Deansgrange, right from the beginning, when it opened in 1865, welcomed people of all religions and none. In other words, it was non-denominational. However, in spite of that, here in Deansgrange, there was still a division between religions. Catholics were buried in one section and Protestants were buried in another. When Deansgrange opened, it covered just 8 acres, which was divided into 2 sections. The south section to the left of the main avenue was reserved for Protestants, and the north section to the right of the avenue was reserved for Catholics. Each section had its own chapel, where funeral prayers were said over the coffins before they were brought to their burial plots. The segregation between Catholics and Protestants in the original cemetery is clearly illustrated by how the victims of one of the worst sea tragedies in Dublin Bay were treated when their bodies were brought here for burial. In 1895, during a ferocious storm in the Irish Sea, the Russian ship, the SS Pam, sought shelter in Dublin Bay and ran aground. Though none of the crew or passengers on the Pam were lost, when a lifeboat rushed to the rescue, it capsized and all 15 lifeboat men were drowned. The lifeboat men were local Protestants and Catholics working together to save lives of those in danger at sea. But when their bodies were brought here for burial, they were segregated into Protestants and Catholics. These are 3 of the Protestant graves. Alexander Williams and his father Henry, the coxswain and ex-coxswain of the ill-fated lifeboat, are buried in this grave. Brothers Francis and George Saunders were also laid to rest in the Protestant section. An image of a lifeboat in trouble on a rough sea is carved at the top of George's headstone, and a capsized lifeboat is shown on the headstone of Francis. Years later, the widow of Francis was travelling from Dún Laoghaire to Holyhead on board the mail boat Leinster when the ship was torpedoed by a German submarine in Dublin Bay. She was one of over 500 who drowned, 11 of whom are buried here in Deansgrange. The remains of the Catholic lifeboatmen who perished trying to rescue those aboard the Pam are buried in the Catholic section of the cemetery. An annual ceremony is held every Christmas Eve to honour the memory of the 15 lifeboat volunteers who died in the Pam tragedy. In the 19th and 20th centuries, relatives took burying their dead very seriously, and it was important that the monuments erected over their buried relatives reflected the family's social status.
Dr. Kavanagh was a chemist who owned several medical halls in the locality. Below the crest is the family motto, Pax et Copia, peace and plenty. Near the Kavanagh vault lies Joseph Cope, a member of the committee that was established in 1861 to develop the new cemetery. And he was its first administrator.
In ancient Greece and Rome, bodies were placed in a sarcophagus such as this, and decomposition took place very quickly. Afterwards, the bones would be removed and buried elsewhere. But Joseph Cope's body is not buried in this sarcophagus. It is simply symbolic. His body is in a coffin lying in a vault below this monument, which can be accessed by this stone slab.
The Notting Monument is the largest in the cemetery. This stone slab covers the vault containing the remains of John Gardiner Notting and his daughter Hilda. John was a wealthy businessman and a baronet. This part of the monument resembles the entrance to his home at St. Helens, Stillorgan, which is now a Radisson Hotel. This mausoleum is one of two in the cemetery. It resembles a Roman or Greek temple with steps leading up to it and columns either side of the arch doorway. That's big enough to walk in and stand inside, and it's roofed.
In a mausoleum, coffins are placed above the ground, not buried in the ground. Because of that, the coffins had to be leaded first, and then the leaded coffin was placed in a large outer wooden coffin, which was then stacked inside the mausoleum.
It contains members of the Glorney family, including Lieutenant Edward Glorney, a pilot with the Royal Air Force, who died in 1918 during the First World War, when a faulty wing caused his plane to crash. This, the second mausoleum in the cemetery, also has a classical look. Originally, there wouldn't have been a metal shield behind the gate, and visitors would have been able to see the coffins inside. We can see from the inscription above the door that this was erected by John McCabe, a local councillor in Blackrock, in loving memory of his beloved young wife, who died aged 28 in 1912.
Beside this mausoleum, there's the Catholic chapel. And below this chapel, we've got the crypt. Only the wealthy could afford to be buried in the crypt. Their bodies would have to be sealed in a lead coffin, which was an expensive process, to prevent the smell of their putrefying remains wafting through the floorboards into the chapel above, where a congregation may be attending a service. The expression, the rotten rich, comes from this particular type of burial practice, because occasionally the coffins weren't sealed properly, and the congregation above could smell the rotten flesh coming from the crypt below.
Some wealthy people were buried rather than interred in a mausoleum, vault or crypt, but they still found ways to display their wealth and status. The Talbot Power plot has several graves. James Power was a publican, and in 1791 he established a successful whiskey distillery in Dublin. The base of the family monument is highly carved, and at its pinnacle are four carved biblical figures. Scottish-born John Dunlop was a veterinary surgeon, but he's better known for inventing the pneumatic tyre.
He was watching his son Johnny playing on his tricycle that had solid wheels, and he was a bit shocked by how much his son was being bumped around on the cobblestones. Dunlop came up with the idea of getting two strips of rubber, sticking them together to form a tube. Then he inflated the tube and stuck them on the wheels of the tricycle, and he was quite amazed by how much less bumping there was. He took out a patent and set up factories, and soon Dunlop pneumatic tyres were being used in racing and leisure cycling in Ireland, England and worldwide.
He died in 1921. His son John died a year earlier and lies with his father in the family grave. Joseph McGrath erected this impressive monument to house the remains of his deceased daughter, Mary Jane, who died in 1947. It was inspired by Michelangelo's Pieta in the Vatican and is constructed of Carrara marble. Joe took part in the 1916 Rising and was a minister in the first Irish Free State government. He founded the Irish Hospital Sweepstakes in 1930, a forerunner of the Irish National Lottery. He died in 1966. Sean Lemass, another veteran of the fight for Irish independence, spent a year in prison after the failed 1916 Easter Rising. After the establishment of the Irish Free State, he co-founded the Fianna Fáil political party in 1926. As head of government from 1959 to 1966, he introduced social and economic policies that were the foundation stone of Ireland's economic growth. He died in 1971. This monument on the grave of Captain James Vaughan is certainly one of the most outstanding in the cemetery. On the top is a Latin cross, and below is a ship's anchor, signifying his connection with the sea. The sword and epaulets shows he was a high-ranking officer, and the laurels at the end of the sword indicates he had an illustrious military career.
Captain James Vaughan joined the Royal Navy in 1841, and one of his first great victories was when he led his troops in the siege and capture of the Russian naval base in Sebastopol on the Black Sea during the Crimean War. He distinguished himself a second time during the India Mutiny when Indian soldiers rebelled against the English colonists. When the mutineers besieged the town of Lucknow, Vaughan led his troops, dragging cannons over large stretches of land,
and successfully relieved the town. He died at a relatively young age of 44 years. Mary Edith Coleman was a nurse with the Red Cross during the Franco-Prussian War of 1870. The German Emperor William awarded her the Iron Cross for her devoted service to both the German and French soldiers wounded during the war. Many soldiers and sailors are buried in Deansgrange Cemetery, including hundreds who joined the British Army and fought for the Allies during the First World War. Four are buried in this plot, and each grave is marked with a headstone provided by the British Commonwealth War Graves Commission. Joseph Edward Woodall is the only recipient of the Victoria Cross in the cemetery. He was awarded this highest and most prestigious award for his gallantry in battles against German soldiers in France in 1918. He was only 22 years old at the time. He died in 1962.
Major Hermann Geuss was a German spy during the Second World War. In 1940, he parachuted into Ireland to seek the assistance of the Irish Republican Army in the German planned invasion of Britain. He stayed here for 7 years, moving from safe house to safe house. In 1947, he was arrested and brought in for questioning. He was threatened with deportation, and fearing that he may be handed back to the Soviets, he committed suicide by taking poison. His funeral service took place here at this Protestant chapel in Deansgrange Cemetery, and afterwards he was buried in a nearby plot. Some years later, his body was disinterred and brought here to this cemetery for burial with other Germans who died either in the First World War or in the Second World War. The German military cemetery here in Glencree, County Wicklow, is the only German military cemetery in Ireland.
Some 50 people killed during the 1916 Easter Rising are buried in Deansgrange. They were rebel Irish volunteers, British Army soldiers and civilians. These memorials honour soldiers and civilians who were killed during the Rising. Peter Ennis is one of them. He joined the British Army and fought for the Allies on the Western Front during the First World War.
Peter was home and leave in Dublin from the Western Front during the Rising, and he was casually walking through the city wearing his British Army uniform, as was customary for soldiers returning from the front, when he was shot and killed.
This large Republican plot honours those who died in the struggle for Irish independence and the Civil War. Buried in the plot is Fiona Connolly, the youngest daughter of James Connolly, one of the leaders of the 1916 Rising. Fiona and her mother were the last people to see James alive before he was executed in Kilmainham Jail.
Dr. Kathleen Lynn was another veteran of the 1916 Rising. She was born in 1874 and was one of the first women to qualify as a doctor in Ireland. She was a suffragette and political activist throughout her entire life.
She supported the strikers during the 1913 Dublin lockout, when employers blocked workers who joined a trade union from entering their workplaces. She became an officer in the Irish Citizen Army, which was founded to protect strikers from the Dublin Metropolitan Police during the lockout. Kathleen provided medical assistance to the Irish rebels in City Hall during the Easter Rising. After spending time in prison for her political activities, Dr. Lynn, with her partner, Madeline French Mullen, established St. Ulton's, a hospital for infants. She died in 1955 and was buried with full military honours. Dr. Augustine Henry began his career as a medical doctor and joined the British Customs Service in China in 1881.
He had an avid interest in horticulture and collected thousands of plants, seeds and specimens from the Chinese interior, which he sent back to the Botanical Gardens in Dublin and Kew Gardens in London. He discovered many new species of plants, some of which he named after himself or his wife Elsie.
He returned to Ireland and became Professor of Forestry at the Royal College of Science for Ireland, in a building on Merrion Street, now known as Government Buildings. He died in 1930. John McCormack was Ireland's greatest lyrical tenor, and his records sold millions worldwide. During the First World War, he moved to America, where he became an American citizen. He was known for his charitable contributions, and in 1928, he was appointed a papal count by Pope Pius XI. He performed before an audience of almost 1 million at the 31st International Eucharistic Congress in Dublin in 1932. He spent his final years in this house, Glenna, in Booterstown, overlooking Dublin Bay. He died in 1945. Delia Murphy was a popular singer of Irish ballads from the 1930s to the 1950s and made almost 80 recordings.
If I was a blackbird, I'd whistle and sing, and I'd follow the ship that my true love sends in.
During the Second World War, she accompanied her husband to Rome, where he was the Irish ambassador. There she helped Vatican official Monsignor Hugh O'Flaherty, also from Ireland, save the lives of 6,500 Jews and escaped Allied soldiers.
After the war, Delia's husband, Thomas Kiernan, became Irish ambassador in several countries, and Delia became a popular and entertaining host at the many embassy gatherings. In 1969, she returned to Ireland, where 2 years later, she died of a heart attack.
Dermot Morgan was an actor who created and starred in a highly successful television series, Father Ted, about a trendy priest assigned to a remote parish in Ireland. The series won 3 BAFTA awards and Dermot won a Best Actor award. He died of a heart attack and his ashes were scattered on his parents' grave. Statues of angels often mark the graves of those who died young. The cemetery has a small plot that was used to bury stillborn babies and young children who died before being baptised. It's called the Angels' Plot, and between 1905 and 1989, about 750 children were laid to rest here. Angel plots in cemeteries were a very important innovation, because until the 1980s, the Catholic Church prohibited miscarried and stillborn babies and children who died before baptism from being buried in church graveyards. Today, Deansgrange Cemetery occupies 70 acres. It's the second largest cemetery in the Dublin area. It's run by Dún Laoghaire, Rathdown County Council. It's now the permanent home for more than 150,000. Though most were not wealthy or celebrities, their modest memorials provide a place for relatives and friends to visit, mourn, and reminisce about those who've passed on to whatever is next after death.